folks, remember when I mentioned to you that I was looking to expand my horizon and open the first North American pterosaur museum? Well, let me show you my concept plan. It goes from the building at 610 Union Street to this. That's my plan. I love the artwork here. One of my graphics designers helped put that together. Appreciate the job he did. So like I said, imagine what can transpire here. Not just fossils, not just imagery, but also eyewitness testimony, corresponding from fossils of thousands of years, soft tissue, all the way to eyewitness testimony to today. And this would also be our headquarters, base one, for all of our research, not to mention the vehicles that will be involved as well. I've been looking at the Resvanis. I've been looking at the Hummers. Been looking at Jeeps. I currently own a Hummer. I really enjoy it. But if we're going to go into another direction, I want to have the right stuff, the right equipment, the right vehicles to get us there. So, a dream in the works. We shall see what happens. Stay tuned. Let's get to our topic for today real fast, okay? Before I introduce my guest. Cynicism, derived from the Greek word mistrust. While both skepticism and cynicism involve questioning assumptions and evaluating evidence, there are key differences between the two mindsets. Skeptics are open to new ideas and are willing to be convicted by the evidence, while cynics tend to be closed-minded and mistrustful, motivated purely on self-interest. Now, why do I bring this up? Dating back to the 1960s, there are a large number of sightings regarding big cats in the UK. Now, I'm not referring to your standard bobcat or cougar, no. I am speaking of something much bigger. I'm also not implying these are saber-toothed cats, also known as Smilodon. No, that's not what I'm talking about here. I'm referring to Black Panthers, leopards, and others that should not be freely roaming the inhabitant area of the rural areas. There is 100% proof that these felines are out there, but the Felintologist don't want to hear it. Hence the use of the word cynicism. So how does this fit in cryptozoology, you ask? Well, it's part of the unknown, the hidden, the animal that we are searching for. Is there truth, these animals freely roaming? Yes, there is. In order to get there first and to show proof of that, I want to introduce to you my guest for today. It has been a while, but she's back, and I hope she's feeling a lot better. This is Robyn Moonshadow on the Ropen Network. How you doing, Robyn?
Hi, I'm good. Thank you. Yeah, I'm feeling better. Just domino of health effects. You know, I'm a healthy person, and I think I'm just at the age where everything just caught up to me. But I'm doing a lot better now. Yeah.
Good.
Thank you.
I won't ask the age because I don't think that's proper to ask of a woman, but she has been doing a lot of treks over the years. And recently she sent her fur off, her Sasquatch fur that she had, off for testing, DNA testing on that one. Can you give us a little bit more information about that, Robyn?
A friend of mine contacted the University of North Carolina, who is doing a very large scale study into different hair. And he had mentioned that a few years ago that, and I don't know if everyone would remember the conundrum that was, where I actually searched here in Canada and all over Canada for someone to look at this hair that I had found, because it's rather unique. I have my own little lab set up in my basement, and I went through all the hair possibilities that it could be and what it might not be, just in case, because you never know. And it's rather unique in the way that it's the cuticle, which is the outside of your hair, that's like a fish scale, is almost triangle in nature. And it was so compressed, it was practically waterproof.
Let's assume there are big cats roaming free in the UK. Large cats like leopards and jaguars have home ranges of several dozen or several hundred square kilometers. There is no reason to believe they would have smaller ranges here in the UK. There are no uninhabited areas of the size. They would encounter roads, they would would come across paths where their paw prints would be noticed by others. Yeah, we'll get to that. If there truly was a big cat on the prowl, the telltale sign would be repeated attacks on sheep. As anyone who ever kept a cat would know, cats chase things which move away from them. Big cats are no different, and if sheep run away when seeing a big cat, they would chase them and grab them. There is no native population of big cats living in the UK, so any such big cats would have been born in captivity with no hunting experience. Sheep in confined fields would be an irresistible target. Farmers would be quick to sound the alarm, and rightly so. This is from Carol Bartik, which is, in my opinion, a cynic of this phenomena. All right? I see you smiling, and I can't help but smiling with this article, too.
I try not to laugh.
Yes, I agree. Yeah. You've read plenty of these articles, too, haven't you, Robyn?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, actually, a family member of mine in the 1950s, early 1960s, who lived in England in a place called Burnsley Jump, and he used to race pigeons. And one of his pigeons got away, and he went to get it. And he actually seen a leopard, a black leopard, from underneath the hill. We've all heard this phrase about sheep, okay? Sheep will not always run from a predator. They just don't know any better.
Mm-hmm.
So they're easy pickings. But as I said, the farmers do complain that their animals are being attacked, even chickens, ducks, geese. Just it's sheep because, like I said, they're easy pickings. And they have been seen. And this is so funny to me because last year, a gentleman found hair in the barbed wire fence, had taken it for DNA analysis, and it came back 100%. It was leopard.
Yep.
So, yes, leopards are in the UK.
And I strongly agree with that, too. It's interesting because some of these articles are fairly new. They're not that old, okay? And it shows how close-minded the so-called professionals are. Who are saying mm-hmm. that, hey, we are cat experts. Really. I think they are thinking inside the box instead of outside the box. The
exactly
animals
so.
Adapt to their environments, mm-hmm. okay? I look at the variations of Felidae involved. About 75% of big cat sightings are melanistic, leopards, black panthers, mm-hmm. 20% are of pumas, and probably 5% are of lynx. So panthers, jaguars, pumas, cougars, and tigers.
Mm-hmm.
You know what? As I think about this a little bit more, Robyn, you brought this to my attention too. The word panther is kind of just something that's made up to identify a black leopard. Okay, so mm-hmm. some have said there's no such thing as a black panther. Your take on that?
Well, the word panther is actually the Latin form for a lot of the big cat names, like for a leopard, that's also called a panther and whatnot. But the word panther is like a blanket term for all the big black cats.
Okay.
But what we have here is the two cats that are black are the jaguar and the leopard.
Okay. Yeah.
And it is the MC1R gene that is responsible for creating the melanistic gene.
Mm.
So black jaguars can produce both spotted and black cubs, but black leopards can only produce black cubs only when both parents are black.
Okay.
So if you have a male and a female, England, and they will find each other.
Yeah. I agree.
A male and a female cats will find each other. If we think about domestic cats, and if one is in season, you get all the males from not just the neighborhood, but pretty much all around the country coming to visit the female cat.
Yes.
So it is a lot like that, but they will find each other. Mm-hmm. And if you've got two, you've got more.
Agree. And I look at this list here, and I'm like, okay, we see jaguars, leopards, we see tigers too. And the tiger is mm-hmm. the biggest cat, I want to say. Mm-hmm. And the jaguar, I think, may yes. be the third largest cat that we have.
The Siberian is the biggest of the tiger. Okay. There used to be several tiger species, but we're down to three. And I've been lucky to see all three of them. Mm. We have the Siberian, Bengal, and the Sumatran, which is their orange is just absolutely bright colored, just very vibrant.
Wow. I look at some of the information regarding their natural habitat and diets, which we have covered some of it. Panthers are strictly mm-hmm. carnivorous and eat only meat. About 90% of their diet is feral hog. Ooh. White-tailed deer, yes, raccoon, and armadillo. Occasionally, they consume rabbits, rats, and birds, occasionally. Even alligators. How about that? Yep. They prefer hot, dense, tropical rainforests. Yes, they do. That's for panthers, though, okay? Mm-hmm. Jaguars mm-hmm. eat a variety of prey that include more than 85 species range-wide. Jaguars prey is about 85 species, including vicarious, capybaras, pacas, aguatus, deer, opossum, rabbits, armadillo, caimans, turtles, livestock, as well as various reptiles, birds and fish species, larger turtles and tortoises. The shells are broken with teeth or a paw is inserted between the top, the carapace, and bottom, plastron. And the turtles' insides are scooped out with breaking the shell, feeding on cattle today may be their response to introduced equivalents of large prey. They're among the most powerful animals on the planet, like 200-pound pit bulls. They're stocky and square-jawed with a bite that can readily crush a turtle's shell. Wow. Or mammal skull. They're also graceful. They can swim and climb. They're beautiful, with coats of pale yellow to tan covered in black spots and rosettes. Jaguars are peerless predators of the Americas, secretive and solitary. There are a few cases of such animals being seen in the UK, such as a puma captured in 1980 and a lynx shot by a farmer in 1991. But according to the UK's Department of Environment, Food and Rural Affairs, DEFRA, there has been no credible evidence of big cats presented to Natural England or a public body responsible. It's just these articles are just so interesting. Well, let's see here. We have Norwich, Hampshire, Staffordshire, Gloucestershire, mm-hmm. Crystal Palace, Cornwall, Carlisle, Britt County. There have been 155 big cat sightings reported to UK police forces in the past 3 years. According to the forces, responding to the FOI request, there are likely many more never recorded. Local newspapers publish dozens of eyewitness reports every year and have helped to firmly establish certain creatures. The surly puma, the beast of Exmoor. Remember that one in local England. And I look at this one, June 30th, 2011, Norfolk black cat. Whether or not it's a large cat, we'll find out. Mm-hmm. June 29, 2011, Kenan Park, panther. June 29, 2011, Gloucestershire, black. Just says black, not black cat. June 11, 2011, Therworth Gardens, black cat. June 27, 2011, Yorkshire, black cat.
Yeah, Yorkshire, yeah.
June 25, 2011, Craven Countryside, black cat. 155 reports to law enforcement, UK police. After reading that top portion, we're not sure if they're really out there. But here we go. 155. That tells me a lot, doesn't it, Robyn?
Even if you take 30% of that and just being very large house cats,
sure,
then you have the other percentage that are big cats of some sort or cat. There has been a Eurasian lynx sighted and shot in the UK, bobcats, pumas. All three of those species have been shot with body. And a lot of time, because the authorities don't want to listen, the body just gets left or thrown off to the side.
That's true. Yeah.
Now, the the law that was passed in the late 1970s, early 80s, what allowed you to keep your exotic pets, but you had to register them. You have to pay to keep them and prove that you can keep them without them getting out. Now, cats are escape artists. Everybody knows this. Even your house cats, they'll sneak out the door just like that. These guys will get out of whatever cage you put them in. They are escape artists. And if they want out, they're going to find a way to get out. And during this time, a lot of people couldn't afford the license to keep the animal. And they admittedly, on record, let them go.
Yes.
Hi, I'm Crystal Jordan of the Ropen Radio Network. The RRN is a proud sponsor of the Wildlife Safari, which began as the vision and dream of one man, Frank Hart. It was Hart's goal to create a facility in the Pacific Northwest that would work to save rare and endangered species from all around the world. Wildlife Safari boasts one of the top cheetah breeding research centers on Earth. It is the number one cheetah breeding facility outside of Africa and number two on the planet. Take a trip past the incredibly inspiring African elephants. Dare yourself to end your journey with a trip through a carnivore loop featuring Wildlife Safari's top cheetah breeding grounds and ferocious Sumatran tigers. So the next time you plan your vacation, be sure to stop at the Wildlife Safari located in beautiful Southern Oregon. You are closer to Africa than you think.
Your exclusive home for cryptozoological talk, the RRN, Salem, Oregon. Let's seek the truth. Welcome back. You're listening to Cryptozoological Talk on the RRN, Ropen Radio Network. Salem is listening. I'm joined again with Robyn Moonshadow from Canada. I like the research she does. And last year, she went out to North Carolina and saw Bishop Bill's escape horse swamp. I got some footage of that. Yeah. Really, really cool. I remember talking about that a while back, and it was kind of neat to have her just show me the footage from that exact location and that swamp, to think that maybe something that was bipedal or reptiloid came out of there and chased Christopher Davis is pretty frightening indeed. But that's not our subject for today. We're actually talking about big cats in the UK and big cats in the US. And I have to wonder, has there been any kind of deaths involved with these larger cats? And a couple names come to mind. Anna Terranova. And in December, in Nailsworth, Rick Minter. I don't know if they were just attacked or they were killed. But apparently those are two people I know of that had some terrible run-ins with these larger cats. Do you think they would probably prefer a human or they just prefer a livestock, so Robyn?
It depends on the cat.
Okay.
We know with the lions of, say, Savo or Ghost in the Darkness, as everybody would be familiar with that. They preyed on humans because the both of them had dental issues.
Oh.
And we're easy prey. You don't have to work as hard to actually get us, as we've talked earlier. So humans aren't a preferred food
for,
well, anything. Just if there was something wrong with them, we're easy picking. Actually, I have the book here, The Lions of Savo. And when they did the autopsy on both of the cats, it showed that there were impala and wildebeest meat also in their stomachs, so, along with, of course, human.
Oh, okay.
But they had some dental issue in their canine teeth, so they couldn't hunt as well.
What
a lot of people don't know is actually there was three, not just the two, there was three. The gentleman shot one about a month earlier who was exhibiting almost the same kind of behavior, but that one, they didn't do an autopsy on that one.
That actually shed some light for me. in a big way, because I did not know that, that if they're having troubles or issues with their teeth, that that would make them hunt a human being instead. And that's really, that makes sense.
They get desperate. They've got to eat. So they'll go after us. Now, as for being just attacked without being a prey item, you scared them, or there's many factors with cats because it comes to personality as well. Like here in British Columbia, a lot of people come across cougars, mountain lions, pumas, same thing again.
Sure. Yeah.
And if you know how to deal with them, you'll be all right. Don't take your eyes off them. Don't turn your back on them. And you holler and yell. Don't bend over to pick up stones. You can like kick your feet at them, make yourself bigger, and you scream and holler and yell at them. Now, I know one case, it's because the gentleman just walked up on her kittens. They were her cubs. They were playing in the middle of the road, and he actually just stopped, and she came at him like a train. But he got out of there.
Okay.
But, remember, big cats are, depending on what they are, they will sneak up on you or they'll pounce you, but don't take your eyes off them.
Exactly. And again, a panther foot pad is shaped like a trapezoid. The top portion of the pad is indented, giving it an M-shaped impression. However, depending on the ground where the track was made, this may not always be obvious and it may appear flattened. The bottom portion of the pad shows three distinct lobes. This is perhaps the most diagnostic feature of a panther track. When we talk about tracks and identifying cats here, something is very, very important. Some of these sightings indeed are just your domesticated house cat, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And you can clearly tell by the shape of a cat. I've got a couple images here. I'm going to see if I can share this with you. I'm going to try. Okay, so it looks like you have a track or something to show us, right?
I do.
Okay, let's take a look.
Last year in July, when I was in Virginia on a Bigfoot trip, and in Virginia, there's been big cat sightings. So we got a giant bag of catnip. It's like, we're going to try it. Huge, huge bag of catnip. And we put it everywhere in this one area. Now we didn't get a giant cat, but we got a bobcat.
Okay.
And they're very close to a very large house cat.
Yeah.
And what's unique is here's her baby. And I got this in the mud. 50 feet from the trailer that I was staying in. So her foot is, here would be her bottom pad and then her toe pads.
I see.
And then her baby.
Very nice.
So catnip does work on bigger cats.
Remember catnip, but be careful. Be careful
somebody,
it lures.
Somebody suggested anchovies or sardines. And I was like, no, I don't need the entire wildlife area of whatever's out there to come to that spot. Catnip is good.
Now, folks, there's actually some different variations here in paw pads that you can get an idea of. You see, I see about four. And then you have your mane in the middle. These are different kinds of pads left by larger cats, okay? So when someone actually gets a cast of a print, you have to look at it closely to determine if we're looking at a dog print or cat print. Clearly, I think we can understand what a cat print is versus dog. Everybody should know what a dog print looks like when they see one.
And size of the factor as well, too. So even a big house cat will still be a house cat print.
Mm-hmm. Well, let me ask you this. Sometimes people have said you got to look at also the impression itself, the weight of the animal. This is key.
Yes.
Because that can tell you a lot about the size, the weight of this particular cat. But what we're also finding here too is that there is a problem. What's being reported sometimes are just your regular house cats. So anyone who's owned a cat should know their frame when they're seeing one. But they automatically think it's a Black Panther out there from that distance of what they're looking at. Because something that's further away can look larger. So that's why you have to do a scale comparison. If they're next to a tree, some sort of piece of landmark that will help to identify the size of this particular animal. And I look at the structure of
body type.
Yeah. Yeah.
So what we have here is a jaguar. I mean, not just the coat. I know they look similar.
Yeah.
But a leopard has spots. So we have the black outline with the orangey yellow in the middle. And they're more, here, sorry, everybody, oval in their body shape. There we go, oval.
Yep.
And when you have a jaguar, these guys are built like a truck because they're powerful. These guys are square.
Okay.
Now that you can tell this guy's an older jaguar. But even their heads are different.
Mm-hmm.
And here's the thing with big cats as opposed to small cats or house domestic cats. There we go. They have pointed ears. Okay, domestic cats have pointed ears at the top. Big cats are round. Even with a case in a lynx. This is Pip. She's a domestic short-haired tuxedo, aren't you? So, and she has very large round feet. Come here. I need you to just sit on your backside for a moment. There we go. Put your paws up. And she's a boxer. I mean, she's a box.
Mm-hmm. We'll zoom in on that.
I'll hold it up again. I'll get in love done. There we go. There we go. Thank you.
And like you said, pointed ears versus rounded.
Yeah, and pointed ears. Even now, Binx, with her being a Burmese, the top of her ears, let me see your face, baby, just slightly rounder than, say, Pip's, but they're still pointed. And the tails are different, and they'll hold their tails different.
Yeah.
You'll find, even in these pictures of the big cats, it's a crook like a cane.
Agree. As I look at some of those images here, it is like a cane. Okay.
And they walk differently. They'll walk with one foot in front of the other, putting the back foot in the paw print of the front. So it's to make less noise.
Sure.
Now, Pip doesn't walk that way. But say, Binx, my Burmese, does. Because she's got that big cat swagger.
Okay. Good to know. But one particular person who is still active is Rhoda Watkins, who I've been reaching out to here and there and actually got me onto a page for learning how to track properly. And Jay Opie, of course. There are team members and expert trackers whom strongly believe the big cat phenomena is the real deal, and me and Robyn agree. The couple took part in a field expedition, part of the film Britain's Big Cat Mystery. Rhoda has been tracking and teaching tracking for 20 years, not just animals, but people too. She said, I learned to track wildlife in the UK first of all. The UK is quite a difficult terrain to track in. There's a lot of leaf litter. The weather is not always great. If it's been raining, things get wiped out quite quickly. Agree. So learning to track small wildlife in the UK is a relatively difficult undertaking. I track people for search and rescue purposes, but I do wildlife tracking as well. And I've spent some time tracking big cats in Africa. So the producers were quite keen to have me on board. Good move. Rhoda says they are definitely in Cornwall, and she's seen the proof. So this is where it gets interesting, Robyn. And this is what you and I enjoy the most. DNA testing of stray hair. Now, we know, according to Monster Quest, they found like species up against the fence that were deceased. Some people came forward suggesting that, hey, this is a big cat. And they even had bones to back that, I believe. We'll get to that later. Proof of leopards specialist tracker Rhoda Watkins has been investigating the existence of big cats in the UK for 2 decades and has seen plenty of evidence out in the field, from leopard footprints to bones hacked by puma teeth. Okay. Mm-hmm. But up until now, there was no DNA evidence of big cats roaming the British countryside, so they say. That was until Rhoda's team successfully recently found irrefutable evidence of a leopard in the countryside near Gloucestershire. Yeah. Her quotes, mm-hmm. I've been investigating sightings for 20 years now, and there's been a lot of trackers before me. I have seen plenty of evidence out in the field, but this DNA find absolutely conclusively proves it. It is what we've been looking for, Rhoda told the Mirror, of the leopard hair they found stuck on a farmer's fence. Yeah, another one stuck on the fence. Mm-hmm. The farmer led the team in the right direction after reporting a spate of mysterious sheep maulings. One of the team members found the DNA evidence. A farmer had a couple of sheep killed that were called, and then people were called to investigate. Rhoda explained, Carl Marshall took on the role of tracker and found a hair on the fence. It turned out to be a leopard, which is just phenomenal. Mm-hmm. After the testing concluded, that has to alone shut up so many people by itself.
It hasn't. I still see it. It hasn't. Like they're out of touch or they're not updated. Something from 2 weeks ago was trying to dispel the myth, and I'm looking at it and it was like,
you're kidding.
This is new. Like, did they not know? Did they not hear about the test, or did they just completely disregard it as nothing?
I didn't know that. Just turned a blind eye?
It doesn't stop. Just a blind eye. I mean, and big cats have been in England for ages. I mean, you can go back to the Beast of Bogman Moor Dartmouth, any of them. And we do find that some of the quote-unquote easier big cats to keep are leopards, pumas, sometimes jaguars.
Yeah.
They are the ones that we see. Now, I'm not saying don't get, actually, I will say that unless you know what you're doing, don't get a big cat. I mean, they are a wild animal, and more times than not, unless you know what you're doing, or you're a zoo or a caretaker, that sort, they're not house cats.
Robyn, why don't you tell me about this jaguar in Texas? I want to make sure we go over that. I've also seen them in Arizona. Clearly images of them in Arizona as well.
Well, it is the only known jaguar in the wild in the United States, and it was spotted on camera right here in Tucson. This is amazing. El Jefe can be seen here in his natural habitat in the Santa Rita Mountains. Just beautiful.
But there's something going on in Texas here, too, with these big cats.
There is. Remember, jaguars used to be all over the Americas.
Yeah.
Not quite as far north as I am, but they used to be all over. And it was like by the 1920s or 30s, they were supposed to have been all wiped out.
Okay.
And they're just making their way back. And a lot of these places where these jaguars are seen is what I would call a gateway.
Mm-hmm.
Where they're just making their way from one part to another. So, and it's just a photo. I had hoped for a video. It's a bit difficult to see. And here comes the problem. If it's not a video, you can't see how it's walking.
Exactly.
But it's got a weird tail going on. It's got the weird tail going on right there. And the head is kind of off. So from what I can see, it could be either or.
All right. Your personal take on that picture, though. Would you say that's a large cat?
I think it could be possible that it's a small leopard.
Okay.
So, and of course, we have other things, too, like black bobcats.
Yeah.
Which are really odd. Okay, the year my oldest granddaughter was born, so 8 years ago, I just happened to look out the window, and I saw a really big black cat out there. And, well, it doesn't quite look like a house cat. What is that? And I looked some more, and I think she was hunting mice. So she jumped to get a mouse. And yeah, that and I'm looking at, that's a bobcat and it's black. And of course I go to get the camera, but the neighbors came home and slammed the door and their car door, and it scared her and she took off. So I couldn't get a picture of her, but she did look like this. So this is a melanistic bobcat. They are just so different looking.
Okay.
See, they don't. Yeah.
That's a bobcat. That's a black bobcat. Gosh, that from the, okay. I know I'm looking at a screen here. But when I look at that first glance, it just looks like a domesticated black cat.
It does.
Yeah.
It does. But again, we still have a little bit of the curve on the top of the ear. Now, he or she really does just look like a great big domestic house cat, but the feet are huge, of course. Yeah, she's only got, well, you don't see a tail. It's just a little bob tail. That's why they're called bobcats. But you still got a bit of a curve on the ear.
Okay.
So the ears are still different. And of course, animals with melanism have yellow eyes or green eyes. And they've got this tufts of hair around there.
I learned quite a bit about the Dene tribe over the years because of Robyn. Every time she's on the show, it makes me want to study even more about it. Robyn, thank you so much for being on the show today and sharing your insights and everything we could learn about these amazing Felidae. They are out there, definitely still free roaming, not just in the UK, but they're in the United States as well, and they're making a big comeback. So be on your guard when you're out hunting or wherever you are. Take Robin's advice, okay? Don't be stupid. I wish we could get the cynics to take her advice as well. Again, Robyn, I appreciate your time. I know we went a little bit longer today.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, I'm glad you were here again. And keep me updated with this DNA sample, okay?
I sure will. When I know, everybody's going to know. No matter what it comes back as, everybody's going to know.
Fantastic. You enjoy the rest of your Sunday, Robyn. We'll talk to you soon.
Thank you. You too.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Okay, bye for now. Bye, everybody.
Folks, thank you so much for watching the Ropen Network on CC Media, YouTube, and Rumble. If you enjoyed this episode and would like to listen to the full non-condensed audio alternative, head over to our Spotify for Podcasters account, which you can find in the link directly below. In the meantime, speak the truth, and we will see you next time on the RRN.